Let's go to Los Angeles, where Steve Skrovan is standing by. Steve Skrovan, co-host the Ralph Nader Radio Hour, heard nationwide on Pacifica. They also have a podcast over there. We have a podcast.
Yeah, so don't separate yourself from this, David. You're actually the cause of this.
Yeah. Should we share how I'm like Daisy and Tom Buchanan, where I create trouble for the world and then walk away?
Yeah. You have all, yeah, you're the guy with all the ideas and none of the follow through.
You want to tell people the nightmare that I created for you?
Well, I wouldn't call it a nightmare because, you know, I'm honored to do it, but you convinced Ralph that we need to do more podcasts. And
Ralph Nader. So I convinced Ralph Nader of something.
Yes, you convinced Ralph Nader of something, and which is remarkable in itself. And then he comes back the next day and says, I've been thinking of what David said, which is already a warning sign. Because if I had a chance to talk to him, I said, never think about what David said. And so now he wants to do 17, 15-minute podcasts about impeachment with the constitutional lawyer Bruce Fine.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to do it all in one day. And that's 8 hours, if you do the math.
Uh-huh.
So, and guess who's not available to do that? David Feldman. Guess who's doing it? 8 hours. It's Ralph and Bruce Fine.
And do you want to know why I can't do it?
Yes. Tell us why.
Because I'm taping a podcast with Triumph the Insult Comic Dog Sunday night in Brooklyn at Murmur.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
It's
a new, impressive.
Hang on. It gets worse.
Yeah.
It's a new game show. I'm being serious. We're doing a pilot for a game show.
Yeah.
It's hosted by Triumph the Insult Comic Dog.
Yes.
And the name of the – I'm not making this up – the name of the podcast, the name of the game show is Let's Make a Poop.
Uh-huh.
It's going to have, I'm serious. Pete Davidson, yeah. Pete Davidson from Saturday Night Live is one of the panelists.
Mm-hmm.
Lawrence O'Donnell from MSNBC is one of the panelists.
Yeah.
And the Mooch, Anthony Scaramucci.
Anthony Scaramucci, who's now built a career out of exploiting his 11 days in the Trump administration.
It's the Mooch and the Pooch. So
let's just tell your audience, this is while I'm spending 8 hours, because Ralph called me, he said, you know what, when Richard Nixon, 1973, fired Archibald Cox, Saturday Night Massacre, Sunday morning I got together with Alan Morrison, who is the founder of the litigation group at Public Citizen, and they filed a lawsuit, which eventually led to Nixon's impeachment. And Ralph is saying, we're at a dangerous point in this country because Trump is intimating in his rallies at a civil war and armed resistance and all of this. So he said, we need to do this. David told me that we need to do a lot of podcasts. So we've got 17 articles of impeachment. I can go over with Bruce Fine, and we'll do them each in 15-minute increments, and it'll take us – we'll do it on Sunday, and that's an eight-hour day. And I'm doing that, and I say, David, this is what we're doing. And you're saying to me, I've got to do
a show.
Let's take a poop.
Let's make a poop with Triumph the Insult Comic
with
Dog.
With Triumph the Insult Comic Dog.
With Pete Davidson, Larry O'Donnell, and Anthony Scaramucci. I had to choose between Ralph Nader. Yeah.
And a constitutional scholar.
Uh-huh.
And Triumph and Anthony Scaramucci.
Yes. And
that's what you chose. And don't think I'm not going to tell Ralph. I'm going to tell Dad on you.
As Jerry Lewis used to say, we need to do the bad so we can do the good. But come on, it's Triumph the Insult Comic Dog.
I love Triumph. He performs a function.
Yes. But I love the fact that...
That's our contrasting days on Sunday.
Yes. I love the fact that after we taped the Ralph Nader Radio Hour this week, heard nationwide on Pacifica, or as a podcast,
download it free from all your favorite podcast formats.
I love the fact that I did this impassioned plea for Ralph Nader to do more podcasting, that America wants to hear from him. And he was he's busy. He's got a new book with Mark Green that he's got to promote, and he's writing, and he's testifying before Congress. And I believe I accused him of not having a work ethic. Is that correct?
You did. You did. Because you said to him, well, you know, some of us have a work ethic, Ralph. And so
a man who writes at least one book a year.
Yeah. And who is noted for working on the weekends. Actually said to me, I can't remember the exact quote, but this morning when he talked to me, he said that, you know, that's the way you win. You got to work on weekends.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're not going to sleep, the forces you're fighting against.
Right, right.
So
I'm
doing available Saturday because you have to go.
I'm working on the weekend.
Poop. Yeah.
He'd be proud of me. I'm working on the weekend. I have to honor my commitments. But what I love about this is I had this impassioned plea, and everybody bit.
Using the words like, I guarantee you will double your numbers. I guarantee. Oh, boy, that better come through, man.
Well, people that should be. How do people download the Ralph Nader Radio, which I consider the best podcast in the world?
It is the most informative, best podcast, and we talk about things that nobody else is really talking about, because you turn on cable news and you're going to hear all about the palace intrigue. Or the election horse race stuff. And, you know, we talk some about that, but we talk about it in a much deeper way. This past few weeks, we've been really featuring whistleblowers. We talked to Tom Mueller, who wrote a book called Whistleblowing in an Age of Fraud, and talked more about more than just political whistleblowers, but a lot of corporate whistleblowing that goes on. And then we, this week coming up, we talked back to George Luber, the guy who blew the whistle on the CDC. He headed the climate change program at the CDC. And when Trump came in, not only did they take the word climate change, the term climate change, off the website, but they canceled a climate summit he was doing because climate change really affects health. And that's what the CDC does. But he blew the whistle on that. They tried to stifle him on that. And then the following week, we're going to be talking to a man named Don Barnett, who is a quality control manager at Boeing in their South Carolina plant, where they're making this, not the Boeing MAX 8, but the 787 Dreamliner plane. And he's talking about all the flaws and all the shoddy construction that the bean counters are making them do on that plane that is only about 8 years old, that plane. And he said usually problems don't manifest until about 10 years in. So he and George Luber won these Civic Courage Awards. So we've been kind of doing a whole whistleblowing series.
Right. And who created the term whistleblower, the modern usage?
Well, Ralph popularized it as a positive term back and had a big conference in 1971, which sort of codified the rules, which were later updated in 1986 on a bipartisan fashion, because Charles Grassley was one of the people who advocated for Whistleblower Protection Act. And it's the thing that idiot Rand Paul now is saying, we need to expose this whistleblower. And
Chuck Grassley is a Republican. He's chairman of the House, the Senate Judiciary Committee
out of Iowa. Yeah. And he is, you know, somebody who supports protecting whistleblowers because they perform an important function. And this so-called principled libertarian, Rand Paul, is wants this whistleblower exposed, well past even the time where the whistleblower is even relevant anymore. Everything this whistleblower said has been corroborated. We're well past that, but he wants to expose him because he needs to suck up to Trump for some reason.
Well, they all have compromise. They all have something that they're trying to hide that Trump knows. You know, when Trump gave out Lindsey Graham's cell phone number, during the campaign, he was essentially saying, Lindsay, I have your number. I'll give out your real number.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised.
Yeah. Hey, as long as I have you here, I want to talk to you about Steven Rattner, because we're dedicating this show to a Wall Street charlatan named Steven Rattner. Elizabeth Warren, who you and I saw speak at a public citizen fundraiser about 4 years ago. In Washington, D.C. And we fell in love with her. I fell in love with her. My daughter was there. And I thought she is the second coming of Christ. I really did. I thought this is the person. And then Bernie ran for president. And so she's my second choice. And she bravely unveiled her health care plan. And it's Byzantine. It's complicated. Not her plan, but healthcare in America is purposely complicated. We've talked about how you can't decipher a bill because they don't want you to. The average American spends $11,000 a year on healthcare. That's paid for by either themselves in cooperation with the government and health insurers. We pay a staggering amount more than any other country. We pay twice as much. Australia, Britain, Canada, France, Japan, we pay twice as much and get worse results, don't we?
Yes, and I'll tell you, the average American pays $11,000 a year. My brother, who is a psychologist, so he has his own business, his own shingle.
He has shingles?
He doesn't have that. That's the vernacular for, hanging a
Yeah.
sign out inside your door.
Yeah.
And he pays $30,000 a year for health insurance between premiums and deductibles, $30,000 a year. This is like a small business, person who has his own business.
For how many people?
It's for he and his wife. And, I guess his two children are still young enough to be on their plan. But it's $30,000 a year, which could have been going to their college education fund. But no, it's got to go to whoever it is, Aetna, whoever.
Okay. So we're talking about Steve Rattner. He's the Wall Street financier. He orchestrated the bailout of GM and Chrysler under the Obama administration. He was like a deputy secretary of the treasury, something like that. And he is now out there attacking, as a lifelong Democrat, he's attacking Elizabeth Warren's new plan, which she has bravely proposed. And he's breaking it down. He's saying, this is going to be the biggest government takeover our economy. Do you want, he's doing charts and diagrams on Morning Joe saying, look how much this is going to be a percentage of our GDP once the government starts taking, and he's giving these numbers. What he fails to tell us is that healthcare, the health insurance companies are 18% of our GDP. Our gross domestic product, almost one-fifth of our GDP, is taken up by health care. So
I love these Wall Street guys, David, who they're worried about somebody like Elizabeth Warren or Bernie Sanders crashing the economy. And the reason they're worried about it is because that's their job.
Right.
They don't want to say, it's our job to crash the economy. Right. We don't want politicians doing it.
And then when we crash it, bail us out. GM.
Bail us out. And Chrysler. You know what? I'll bail out GM. And, they'll get whole. And we don't get anything for that.
Right. So he's on Morning Joe. And by the way, MSNBC, which is financed by the pharmaceutical industry.
I mean, I was headed on today. The other thing is the healthcare. Humana is doing, Medicare Advantage commercials on all these cable networks.
Yeah.
So they're all dependent on the healthcare industry and the pharmaceutical industry. A lot of pharmaceutical commercials because it's old people like us who watch this stupid cable news, and they're marketing all that stuff to us.
They're telling us a story about Trump. That the problem in America is Trump. That's the neoliberal party line. Everything will be okay once we get back to the halcyon days of Obama and Joe Biden. Now here's a commercial for Elvira.
Yeah.
And Smegma Lou for, you know, whatever. I'm going, what the hell?
Yeah.
And it's the pharmaceutical industry that is financing MSNBC. And if you watch Morning Joe, Micah and Morning Joe, and I listen to them because I love that show. It starts at 6 a.m. and goes to around 9. I listen to them on the treadmill. And Morning Joe, Joe Scarborough, is brilliant.
And that's my, by the way, that's my sort of a nickname for my morning bomb movement, Morning Joe.
Morning Joe, yes.
Hi, I'm Morning Joe.
So
hello, Joe.
Yeah, I say okay, boomer to mine. So, you know, and you know, I love Mika and Joe because I listen to them as a podcast. I don't watch them, and there's this tension between them because it's Lucy and Desi. They're married, and you know they hate each other. And my theory is that
they're really married.
Yeah, they're married. Yeah.
Wow.
And my theory about Mika and Joe is, they fell in love. They were working together. I always, this is just what I observed. I always thought it was a very abusive relationship. I felt that Mika, I intellectually abused. I thought she was intellectually abused by Joe on the show. And at the height of the Me Too movement, you know, NBC is a, I believe, is a rape culture. You know, they all cover up for Matt Lauer. And Tom Brokaw, these women are coming forward, you know, and this is just a theory that I'm entertaining, but I think this is my, this is how I watch Morning Joe, based on no knowledge, just my fever dream of a psychosis, that Mika was going to Me Too Joe, but then decided, you know what, I want to own this man. I'm going to make him marry me, and I'm going to have the cudgel that keeps him in line. I'll go to, you want to divorce me? I'm going to human resources, Joe.
Yeah. Wow.
That's how I watch the show. It's probably not true, but I think it is.
But it gives that little extra edge.
Uh-huh.
Because you never know when she's going to blow the whistle on him.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
So they are the editorial board of MSNBC. If you want to know what MSNBC really thinks, watch Morning Joe. They are the heart and soul of MSNBC. So he has this guy Ratner on talking against Medicare for all. Let's listen to, do you mind if I play you some clips?
Go right ahead.
All right, here we go. This is from Morning Joe.
Even the taxes that she's proposed on the wealth.
This is Ratner.
Right.
The Wall Street financier who does the, you know, is on Morning Joe all the time.
Appropriately has Rat in his name.
Yes, yeah.
Even the taxes that she's proposed on the wealthy, which I think are kind of ridiculous, taxing wealthy on over 100% of their investment income.
Well, that would be ridiculous to tax the wealthy on 100% of their investment income. Is that Elizabeth Warren's plan?
Well, Elizabeth Warren's plan is any, I don't know what the exact number is, but it's, it's at a number when you are, you ought to have enough by then.
Yeah. But he's saying, you know, that he's saying
after
that
a certain, it's after a certain number of billions or millions of dollars. And he doesn't like that, surprisingly.
Yeah, but he's saying, he's this Wall Street financier who says, you know, you got to pay attention to the numbers and you got to be honest with the American people about what your plan is. And this is Steve Ratner on MSNBC.
Even the taxes that she's proposed on the wealthy, which I think are kind of ridiculous, taxing wealthy on over 100% of their investment income.
You would think that, you know, maybe you would pay attention to the plan if it's so important. And he's telling us that the plan is to tax the wealthy at 100%.
Over 100%.
Over 100%. He thinks that's kind of ridiculous.
Only 4.4 trillion, and she's got to come up with this 34 trillion. And so there is real no way. She's used every gimmick you can find. But at the end of the day, if you really want to do this, the middle class is going to have to contribute to it.
Absolutely. The middle class is going to have to contribute to this because we just can't find the money. Apparently, we need to find about $1 trillion, right? Right now, we spend $4 trillion a year on health care. It's split between the government and the private sector. $2 trillion a year is paid for by Medicare and Medicaid and the VA. And then the other $2 trillion comes from, you know, the health insurance industry.
Right.
And then us going out of pocket. So we have to find $2 trillion a year.
And he doesn't want you looking in his wallet.
No. Why would that happen? Why would he have to give up his hard-earned cash that comes from the federal government?
You know, Jim Vandehei.
So here's Morning Joe talking to Jim Vandehei from, I believe, Politico or Axios.
You know, okay. Jim Vandehei, I really don't know where to begin in talking about what a bad idea this is, what a bad policy this is, how nothing adds up in it.
This is policy. This is policy. This is Joe Scarborough from MSNBC, former Republican congressman, talking policy, right?
And when he was a former Republican congressman, guess what kind of insurance he had? Government health insurance.
Oh. Well, then he knows firsthand how bad it must be.
Yeah.
Hmm. I wonder if the girl who died in his office under mysterious circumstances had government health insurance. Hmm. Probably that's why she died, right?
Yeah, sure.
You could start by just talking about how Medicare, in its current form, is facing a funding crisis, is facing bankruptcy down the road, and then she's going to expand it for everybody. But
is Medicare facing bankruptcy down the road?
You know what? Every company in the world is potentially facing bankruptcy down the road.
Yeah.
Medicare is solvent, as is Social Security. That's the thing about these numbers for Social Security, Medicare, as they say, 25 years, it could go bankrupt. And if you were to say to any businessman that you've got 25 years, you would go, hooray, hip, hip, hooray.
Right.
You can't project 25 years into the future. And there are always adjustments that you can make along the way that make it go in the right direction.
Sounds to me they just don't like Medicare.
It's a scare tag. They don't like they like the commercials they get from the pharmaceutical companies and the health insurance companies that keep them on the air. That's what they like.
Let's continue.
Again, that's too simple for some people to figure out. But then, can you imagine?
So he's making us feel stupid. It's too simple for people to figure out.
But then, can you imagine on the campaign trail who running against a plan that takes away 165 million people's private health care plans, takes away the health care plans of union members who have negotiated for those plans through the years, of workers all over America, taking away those health care plans, and then telling everybody, all right, listen, don't worry, we're here. The government is now in charge of your child's health care plans. We're going to tell you what pediatrician to go to. We're going, it's all government. Everything's going to have to be approved by government bureaucrats in Washington, D.C. Can you imagine a less popular plan in the general election?
All right.
Steve, I can't imagine you wanting to respond to that. Let me ask you a question, Steve Scrovan.
Yes, sir.
Besides being the director of An Unreasonable Man, the documentary about Ralph Nader.
Yeah.
Without embarrassing you, is it fair to say that you are a wealthy man compared to most people?
Yes.
Okay. You got lucky.
That's fair.
Is that fair to say?
Yes.
You're a lucky man.
Exactly.
With no discernible talents.
Well, mediocre talent, got lucky.
You got tapped by Skull and Bones at Yale. Is that correct, sir?
Am I at a congressional hearing?
Yes. Answer the question. Were you or were you not tapped by Skull and Bones while you were attending Yale?
I don't recall.
Yes or no? Are you a member of Skull and Bones?
Yes.
Yes, you are. Did you or did you not attend Yale?
Yes, I did.
Were you planted in Hollywood by Colby from the CIA as an operative?
Yes, I was.
And you became a sitcom writer as part of MK Ultra to brainwash and sedate the American people into being more passive.
Yes. It was a long con. It was a long game.
Okay. In all seriousness.
A very indirect way.
Okay. So
mind control.
For my new listeners, Steve Skrovan is a very successful comedy writer. And I resent that. And he has a lot of money. And I resent that even more. Do you have a Cadillac health care plan provided to you by your union?
Yes. And you know why they call it Cadillac?
Why?
Because it covers things.
I thought you were going to say it doesn't work.
Because it's obsolete. It's bloated and obsolete. No, because it covers things.
Yeah.
That's what a Cadillac plan is. So let's knock down a couple of Morning Joe's assumptions here. And since we talked about unions, I could do that one first. Unions, we have to negotiate every 3 years, like the Writers Guild. My Writers Guild has to negotiate every 3 years with the big studios, which are now down to, I think, five. So that's a whole other problem of media consolidation.
And you're involved with the Writers Guild.
I'm a captain, you know, and
a captain of labor, not of industry, of labor.
I'm with the rank and file.
Yes.
And we would love to have healthcare taken off the table, because what happens in our negotiations is they can say, well, we'll raise your minimums, but we're going to have to take away some of your healthcare benefits. So I think both sides would love to have that taken off the table. I know the union would, because now it's no longer leverage to keep down our minimums. And I'm sure, you know, why would any company want to keep paying all of these healthcare contributions?
Yeah, we talked about this.
The business community should be all over this.
On the Ralph Nader Radio Hour, or Nationwide and Pacifica, or you can download it as a podcast, we talked about this. It's this Saturday. It'll be on in L.A.
Yeah.
The corporate CEOs love corporate socialism. There's no reason you can't call in the heads of the five families and say, listen, I'm going to give you health care. I'm going to relieve you of this burden. They're not going to say, but what about our friends over at Anthem and Blue Shield? And they're going to go out of business. You think they care?
Yeah, I have no idea what they're thinking, and I don't know why they're not pushing. I mean, Ralph talks about from Canada? Was his name Jack Smith, who was head of GM in Canada?
GE.
Yeah. He came down to America, and they asked him about
healthcare.
The Canadian healthcare.
He
said it worked pretty well up there.
Yeah.
Yeah. So,
and do you live in fear? Do you think anybody? I mean, this is almost becoming cliche. Do you live in fear of a government takeover of your health care? Do you live in fear?
First of all, that is a scare term: government takeover of health care. It's not a government takeover of health care, and I'm amazed at how people don't understand this. I understand how Morning Joe willfully does not understand that,
right?
Because, as Upton Sinclair said, it's very difficult to get someone to understand something when their living depends on them not understanding it. So
I didn't. What does that mean? I don't get that.
That means it's hard to get somebody to commit somebody to something when they're getting paid by people when it's on it.
I don't get that. I don't know what you mean by that. But go ahead.
I'm trying to get you to understand something.
Go on.
It's very hard to get you to understand something when...
All right, so...
Your livelihood depends on you not understanding it.
I see. Okay, so...
So that's one... So the union thing right there, is oh, you're going to take away our the thing we negotiated hard for. Well, we had to negotiate hard for against these bastards because we don't have government health insurance. And that's what we're talking about. We're not talking about government takeover of health insurance. We're talking about We're talking about the government taking over health insurance. It's still privately delivered. It's not. We're not nationalizing hospitals. We're not making doctors work for the government.
And are they dictating which doctors we get to see?
No, it's private. Like Ralph always says, this is his mantra: privately delivered. Everybody in, nobody out. Free choice of doctor and hospital.
In fact,
that's
right now, right now, we're dictated to as to who we get to see. Right?
Yes, except it's by an insurance company.
Well, I rather have an insurance executive
cover you.
I want my
only way they make money is to not cover you.
You're going
to
trust a government bureaucrat to decide that I can't? Yeah, I know.
I'm going to trust a government bureaucrat. Look at all of these people who are coming forward. These government bureaucrats from the State Department, who are career diplomats, who believe in their job, who believe in their mission, just like the guy week on the radio show, George Luber, who believed in the CDC, believed in the mission, could have had a lucrative job at Stanford, but instead wanted to work at the CDC because he believed in service, and that was after 9/11. That was his way of going to war on behalf of the country.
Are you saying, Steve Skrovan, that if men and women who serve in uniform are heroes, the same can also be said of the men and women who work in our government?
I think 99% of the men and women who work in our government are there for the mission. If you read Michael Lewis's book, The Fifth Risk, he goes through a lot of these agencies, like the Agriculture Agency and the Commerce Agency. And all he encountered were people who believed in the mission and just want to do their job. They don't get paid a lot of money, but they can take their conscience to work, as Ralph always says. And they're being slandered by hacks like Morning Joe, who call them, you want your health care taken over by government bureaucrats and them deciding who you see. They're completely misrepresenting both Bernie and Elizabeth Warren's plan, which is on the Canadian model, which is all it is national health insurance, single payer, privately delivered, private doctors. You have to, you know, I have a cardiac appointment with a cardiologist and
Dr. Vinnie Boombots.
Dr. Vinnie Boombots, 6 months to get the appointment. That's in a private system here.
Yeah,
that's what we have, because we have a shortage of doctors. And doctors have to go into specialties in order to pay off their debts. So while these Wall Street hacks are worried about the size of government and what this costs and this costs, they completely lose the moral principle argument. I could argue the numbers. You could argue that, like we've already said, we spend twice as much on health care. I don't know how that doesn't drag down the economy. And it's also the leading cause of personal bankruptcy. They never talk about that. And I just get pissed off at these hacks who – and they call themselves Democrats who are mouthing these right-wing talking points.
Well, politically, you know, Morning Joe watches the horse race and he says you can't win – threatening to take away America's private health insurance.
You know what? He's right about one thing. He's right about, and we've talked about this too, is that it's a much easier case to make when you're talking about taking away something from somebody that they already have. I mean, that's why when they wanted to take away Obamacare or in the early years of days of the Trump administration, all of those town halls with all those Congress people going back to their districts, they got bombarded and they dropped that because you were taking away something that they got. It's much harder to convince people of something that they don't have, but they deserve. it's much easier to make the argument about taking away something. And I think, yes, you would be taking away, as Donald Trump says, their beloved private health insurance. First of all, I don't know who's in love with their private health insurance.
Nobody.
But
nobody.
You've got to argue this in a way where, okay, you want to talk about taking away stuff? Here's what we're going to take away. We're going to take away the stress of you wondering if you have coverage or not. Because even people who have plans find out, oh, this is not covered. We're going to take away the stress of you worrying about going bankrupt because you don't have health insurance. We're going to take away the stress of you having to pay premiums, of having to pay deductibles. That's what's going to be taken away. This is the way these things need to be argued. And people like Joe Scarborough have no idea because they live in their own wealthy bubble.
Mm-hmm.
And they're worried about, and Steve Ratner, they're worried about slowing down the economy when it's their job to slow down the economy.
Right. They live in a wealthy bubble because they've made choices in their lives to parrot talking points that are lies. That's why they're in that wealthy bubble. Because in the end,
they refuse to grasp, because I don't know, there's some philosophical thing about big government. And we're not talking about big government. We're talking about national health insurance. We're not talking about the government taking over your health care and bureaucrats making decisions about what doctor you can see and what treatment you can get. First of all, that's already being done by insurance companies. We're talking about private health insurance. Both Bernie and Elizabeth are talking about free public education. Those are things that build the economy from the bottom up. These people are top-down people. They're worried about themselves. They're worried. We talked to David Freeman, who talks about climate change. He talks about the intelligent deniers and the dumb deniers. The dumb deniers are like Trump. They don't understand it. But they're intelligent deniers who understand it and think it's true, but they don't do anything that will make a difference to Mother Nature. Well, it's the same thing in economics. They talk a good game, but they don't want to do anything that will change the system that has made them wealthy.
You know, there's a great scene in The Crown when Queen Elizabeth dresses down Winston Churchill for not telling her about his stroke, and she really gives it to him. And John Lithgow, playing Winston Churchill, says, "My queen, you have finally earned your ermine. You've arrived," with tears in his eyes. And I feel right now that you are my queen, and I am Winston Churchill, and it's time for me to step aside. You have earned the title. Hey, Steve Skrovan, let's do this next week. Great job. Steve Skrovan co-hosts the Ralph Nader Radio Hour, and you can hear it on iTunes, Stitcher. What's the website for the Ralph Nader Radio Hour?
RalphNaderRadioHour.com.
And download it, or call your local radio station and say, "I want the Ralph Nader Radio Hour heard nationwide on Pacifica." You're also on the board of directors of Public Citizen.
Public Citizen, which is the group that Ralph originally founded. He hasn't been involved in the last 35 years. But, I've been about 10 or 11 years I've been on the board. And every year in October in L.A., we do a gala benefit, stand-up comedy benefit, called Stand Up for Main Street. And that's kind of what I've been able to contribute to as Public Citizen.
And you really are Skull and Bones.
Yes.
Okay.
I embody the whole ethos.
No, but you did. You were a member of Skull and Bones.
Yeah. Well, you mentioned that every time.
Because I'm not sure who I'm really talking to. That's why.
Well, here's what I'll say, is that I can be, if you're a conspiracy believer.
Mm-hmm.
And wanted to create a conspiracy based on associations, I'm the perfect test for that, because you could go either way with me. You could say, Yale, Skull and Bones, wrote jokes for George H.W. Bush, oh, he's a Republican operative, right wing operative. Then you could look at me and say, okay, union guy, Ralph Nader, made a movie about Ralph Nader.
You're a double agent.
I'm a double agent, yeah. So you don't know who. You could make the case for me being either one of those things.
You were the comedy writer who came up with that bit where George Herbert Walker Bush throws up on the Japanese prime minister.
Yes.
But
yes.
It backfired on him. But it backfired on him.
Well, he didn't. I told him he had to make more noise. It's only really funny when you go, you know, and he just kind of flopped. You know, he didn't commit to the bit.
Stay on the line for one quick second. Thank you.